advised by the Institute for International and European Affairs and the French Embassy here in Ireland to mark and also to celebrate International Women's Day. I'm Martina Fitzgerald, and I'm delighted to be chairing this discussion with three very distinguished and also very successful women from Ireland, France, and Mali, who have each served at a senior level in political life. So we are delighted to be joined this morning by Frances Fitzgerald, who is a member of the European Parliament representing Dublin and a former Taoiseach, Kadiatou Konare, the Minister for Culture, Crafts and Tourism of Mali, and Najat Vallaud-Belkacem, the Director of One France and a former French Minister. Now, before we begin, I would just like to run through the format of today's event. I will shortly hand over to the French Ambassador to Ireland, Vincent Guiron, and the Cultural Councillor of the French Embassy here in Dublin, Mariam Diallo, who has been instrumental in organising today's event. I will then formally each introduce each of our guest speakers and get their perspectives on political life and decision making, also the role of education and equality in society as a whole, and also their visions for the future post the pandemic. Now, this session will be an hour long in total, and one of our speakers, Minister Konare, will be speaking in French today. And we will have live French to English interpretation throughout this discussion. And to avail of this service, you can simply click on the interpretation button represented by a globe icon at the bottom right of your Zoom screen, and then select English in the language options, which you will see displayed. If you don't wish to avail of the service, you can click off, and the instructions will be made available also in the chat room. And there will also be ample opportunity for members of the audience to participate. You can submit your questions with your name and perhaps your affiliate organisation via the Zoom Rooms Q&A function at the bottom of your screen. And please keep sending your questions throughout this morning's event, because we are leaving time to answer them. Now, with that, I would like to welcome the French Ambassador to Ireland, Vincent Guiron, and the Cultural Councillor at the French Embassy, Mariam Diallo. Ambassador.
Thank you very much, Martina. Good morning to our distinguished panelists and to the audience. Bonjour, mesdames. Bonjour à tous. I'm especially pleased and honored to open this debate on the International Women's Day. This year, France and Mexico will also be co-chairing the 2021 Generation Equality Forum, in French, Forum Génération Égalité, a global gathering for gender equality organized by UN Women. Thank you, Mrs. Fitzgerald. Merci, Madame Konare. Merci, Madame Vallaud-Belkacem, for your participation to this exchange. And thank you for IEA for organizing it. And I also want to share my speaking time with Mariam Diallo, our cultural advisor at the French Embassy, who has enthusiastically and resolutely carried out this project at the French Embassy in Ireland. Thank you, Mariam.
Merci, Monsieur l'Ambassadeur. It is a great honor for me to be able to bring together three countries that are so dear to my heart, Ireland, Mali, and France. Even though the role of women within political institutions has increased in recent years, we know that the road ahead will still be challenging. Allow me to express my admiration of our distinguished panelists coming together from different backgrounds and cultures. Thank you for being here. While the COVID-19 pandemic has placed women all over the world in even more precarious positions, this International Women's Day, your journeys and your testimonies will be incredibly encouraging for the future and for a more equal recovery for women all over the world. Merci. Thank you.
Thank you, Mariam, and thank you, Ambassador. And now I'd like to introduce our guest speakers. We're delighted to be joined this morning by Frances Fitzgerald, an MEP representing Dublin. Frances has served in national politics for more than two decades. She's a former Taoiseach who has held numerous high-profile cabinet ministries, including justice and equality, Business, Enterprise and Innovation, and Children and Youth Affairs. She has also served as a chair of the National Women's Council of Ireland, vice president of the Women's Lobby, and is currently a member of the Economic and Monetary Affairs Committee, the Women's Rights and Gender Equality Committee, as well as the Development Committee in the European Parliament. You're very welcome, Frances. We're also joined this morning by Kadiatou Konere, who is the Minister of Culture, Crafts and Tourism of Mali. She is well known in the world of African publishing, is passionate about culture and is also a human rights activist. She also founded a publishing house which has made a significant contribution to African heritage. And under the direction of the Malian journalist Ramata Diawuru, she brought together key figures to write the collective work about the Women's March, a chronicle of the Malian Revolution. Now, finally, we would also like to welcome Najat Fallo Belkacem, who is the France director of WON, an NGO campaigning to end extreme poverty and preventable diseases. She also has a distinguished political career, serving as Minister for Women's Rights and was a government spokesperson under President Hollande. And she also holds the title and the distinction of being the first woman in France to be appointed Minister for National Education, Higher Education and Research. You're all very welcome. And we truly do have a very distinguished panel this morning. And finally, if you do want to get involved in this morning's webinar on social media, you can use the handle on Twitter at IIEA and at France in Ireland, as well as using the hashtags, hashtag IWD2021 and hashtag choose to challenge, which of course is the theme of International Women's Day. And this event is public and it is also being live streamed on YouTube. So without further ado, let's begin our discussion. I would first like to turn to our guest speakers and to Frances Fitzgerald. Frances, can you tell us about your own political experiences in terms of seeking and entering office and decision-making in political life at a senior level?
Good morning, everyone. Obviously, Martina, thank you for that question. And I'd like to also thank the Institute and the French Embassy for having such an international panel and focusing on International Women's Day. And I suppose what I would say at the moment in regard to International Women's Day is that it is a time for celebration, but also for taking an audit with COVID and the implications of COVID and the differential effect it's having. My own political career, I never started out really to be a politician. I was a social worker. I did a basic social science degree and then I did a master's in social work. And it was really my experiences of both my social work in London and Dublin and seeing social problems as they emerged that gave me a passion, I think, for equality, inclusion and diversity. And that really I've carried right through my political career. And I've been very fortunate and honoured to have the opportunity to be a minister, as you said, and to work on those issues at a ministerial level and to bring forward legislation in relation to those areas. And I suppose when I was working early on as a social worker in Ballymun in Dublin with community and with families, I focused on work with families and children in the early years. It was ironic then later on I became, not really ironic, but I mean, I suppose I never expected it that I became the first minister for children. And it was really my work on equality, on women's issues, on reading books like Betty Friedan and The Second Stage, following American feminism, organizing conferences here and bringing people from abroad to speak at them, and sort of gaining understanding about the structural inequalities in our society that led me into politics after having been chair of the Women's Council for 4 years. And, you know, I've had the ups and downs of any political career, and you certainly have to be resilient, I would say. And I suppose that the themes I'd focus on at present is that we still have unfinished democracies, as I would call them. We still lack the critical mass of women and men working together. We tend to have too low percentages in decision making of women, both in politics particularly, but in many other areas of business as well. But I would say it's all changing. You know, we are on a journey. And, you know, again, well done to France and Mexico for doing generation equality this year. Young women, I think, are becoming more and more activist. We're seeing the Me Too movement. I think there is room for optimism, but equally, we have to be very aware of the challenges still out there. When you think in America, for example, 61% of those who go for food stamps are women. You think of poverty around the world. In Europe, you think of the gender pay gap, still 14%. The pension gap is 39%. So there are many ongoing areas that we have to work on. And I started off by saying we have to recover from COVID and make sure that equality doesn't regress, because that's the big danger at present, given the differential impact of COVID. So I would say it's a privilege, and all of us here were ministers or are ministers, and it's fantastic because you can influence and you can bring about important change. And that's the privilege of being in politics, I believe. And that's why it is very worthwhile. And that's why we have to ensure more women come into politics. But I've, you know, being a mother of three sons has influenced me, because you understand childcare issues in a very direct way when you're facing them yourself. And there is evidence that women deal more with social issues and bring up social issues. By the way, Martine, I just discovered last night that there is one study showing that women are more active in politics and bring forward more legislation. I was delighted when I had found that. I didn't know that was true, but I came across one study in a book I was reading last night about that. So I think women contribute a lot would be my point when we're there. And certainly being in cabinet, and I'd conclude on this, I have seen the difference between having two women in cabinet, three, four, five, and out of 15. So again, getting that critical mass, I think, is really important.
And that record of four Irish women in cabinet was actually recorded in 2014 when you were a minister at that stage. And you've spoken about how that changed the dynamic within cabinet. I'm next going to ask Minister Conare also about her political experiences. But first, I want to ask her about her outfit, because it is a very special outfit for today, for International Women's Day, and also has a link to some women who are working in your country. Minister.
Merci beaucoup, bonjour et bonne journée du 8 mars à tout le monde. Je voudrais d'emblée préciser un élément qui me paraît important, fondamental. Je ne suis pas un pur produit de la société civile telle qu'elle est admise par les organisations internationales. Je ne suis pas non plus une militante politique, mais le sens de mon engagement social et intellectuel, je pense le tirer vraiment du militantisme politique, la force du militantisme politique, mais aussi je le tire de l'engagement, de la créativité de la société civile. Lorsque je suis donc arrivée, j'ai été nommée ministre de la culture, de l'artisanat et du tourisme de mon pays. Je suis arrivée là avec un background d'engagement, comme background, un engagement social, un engagement intellectuel. Et depuis quelques mois, je me rends compte et je réalise que peut-être faire de la politique, c'est tout simplement essayer de traduire en acte concret notre engagement social, notre engagement intellectuel. Si vous le permettez, je vais quand même revenir un peu sur cette notion d'engagement social et sur la notion d'engagement intellectuel. L'engagement social, pour ce qui me concerne en tout cas, prend ses racines encore là, au cœur de l'enfance, au cœur même du système éducatif. Vous savez, au Mali, lorsqu'on éduque une fille, on lui apprend très tôt à prendre soin des autres, à s'occuper de la famille, de la fratrie. Moi, je suis aînée de famille, donc très vite, j'ai appris à avoir cette responsabilité, m'occuper des plus petits. Et à côté, souvent dans la grande famille, de la maman, de la tante, des cousines, des grandes cousines et même des grands-mères, on apprend à assister les unes et les autres, à faire à manger, à s'occuper de la maison, à rendre la maison plus conviviale. Et je me souviens, et je le dis très souvent lorsque je pense à cette époque de mon enfance où les principes ont été inculqués, je pense très souvent à une responsabilité qu'on m'avait assignée. C'est que le matin, tôt avant d'aller à l'école, j'étais celle qui devait faire à manger pour ma grand-mère. Et je ne me souviens pas avoir raté une seule fois ce rendez-vous avec ma grand-mère. Et voyez-vous, cela donne des responsabilités. Cela vous apprend très vite, très tôt, à vous occuper de la communauté. Et après, lorsqu'on devient adulte, mon cas particulier, je pense que c'est un cas assez général au Mali, parce que vraiment, on est dans un mode d'éducation communautaire, partagé, qui repose sur nos traditions, sur nos valeurs culturelles. Donc, ce que je veux aussi dire pour, en ce qui concerne ma vie de femme, lorsque je suis devenue mère de femme, maîtresse de foyer, j'ai appris, comme je pense des générations de femmes de mon pays l'ont appris, que le bien-être d'un foyer, le bien-être d'une maison repose essentiellement sur les épaules d'une maîtresse de maison. Donc, il repose essentiellement sur la femme. On a le devoir de s'occuper des enfants, mais pas que de ses enfants, des enfants des autres, c'est-à-dire les cousins qui arrivent à la maison, les petits-neveux, les belles-sœurs qui sont là, les belles-mères qui sont là. On est assailli de responsabilités. Et c'est la maîtresse qui gère tout ça. Elle doit veiller au bon fonctionnement de tout. Et en plus, je crois, on ne pardonne jamais à la maîtresse de maison de faillir à cette responsabilité de s'occuper de la famille, de s'occuper des autres. Et on est très souvent, peut-être les premières levées et les dernières couchées. Parce qu'encore une fois, il faut veiller sur tout, il faut veiller sur tout le monde. Les femmes du Mali, et je pense que je suis là aussi, en tant que maîtresse de maison, bien placée pour le dire, ont mille et une charges à assumer, mille devoirs à assumer. Et au cœur de la fatigue par moment, et lorsque je n'en pouvais plus, permettez-moi de vous faire cette confidence, je disais, mais je crois que les femmes du Mali sont des chefs d'État. Tout ce qu'elles organisent, tout ce qu'elles mettent en marche, et le leadership s'installe automatiquement. Elles ont un leadership naturel qui est le fruit du mode d'éducation, encore une fois transmis de génération en génération, mais qui est aussi le fruit d'un mode d'organisation de la cellule familiale où tout repose encore une fois sur les épaules de la maîtresse. Mais elles font tout cela avec beaucoup de discrétion, dans une grande discrétion. Il y a un adage populaire de notre pays qui dit d'ailleurs, dans la basse-cour, la poule sait que le jour s'est levé du moins, mais elle laisse le soin au coq de chanter. Cela veut dire ce que cela veut dire. Ça traduit toute la grande discrétion avec laquelle les femmes arrivent à prendre les responsabilités, à s'occuper de la communauté. Et en conclusion, je dirais que cela nous prépare vraiment à assumer un leadership, qu'il soit politique, qu'il soit social. En tout cas, cela nous positionne naturellement à prendre des responsabilités. Il y a une condition féminine au Mali. Et cette condition féminine, encore une fois, est le fruit d'une éducation, est le fruit d'un parcours que je nommerais parcours de femme du Mali. Je vous remercie.
Thank you, Minister, and also for, I suppose, really dealing with one of the main obstacles for political participation by women, childminding. Just to remind everyone that in relation to the interpretation, the minister is speaking, if you press French to hear the interpreter. And now we're going to move on to our next guest speaker, Najat Vallaud-Belkacem, the director of One France, to talk about her experiences in political life.
Hi, from Paris. I'm so delighted to be part of this wonderful and powerful panel. Thank you very much for your invitation. Well, to try to answer your question, I was absolutely not predisposed to enter in politics. To give you a little bit of background, I was born in Morocco. I arrived in France only when I was 4 years old. I did not speak French. So my childhood was not filled with politics, and especially since my parents didn't vote. That didn't mean I didn't have any commitments, but I have been fighting poverty and inequalities in NGOs from a very young age. And I certainly was not imagining myself as a politician when I was a kid. So I truly started to take interest in politics after high school, when I studied law and then joined Sciences Po, which is a high school, which made it possible for me to do internships in this area, for instance, in the French National Assembly. And this made me better understand how legislative action works and how, as a politician, you could change things for the better. And what made me finally go into politics was the 2002 presidential election in France, when the extreme right candidate arrived in the final round of the election. And that was a pure shock for me and for many people who absolutely did not expect that to be possible. This event made me realize that I had to do something for my country and for the values I believed in, because I had a voice and a willingness to make France a better place. Having a family coming from abroad was a true opportunity for me, because it made me see the world differently. It gave me the ability to adapt myself to different situations and to understand very diverse points of view. It wasn't as obvious when it comes to being a girl. As a teenager, being a girl meant that I had a bit less opportunities than my male relatives for going out, for example. So that made me quite mad. Most importantly, I witnessed that for my mom, for instance, being a girl meant that she had less autonomy and had way less opportunities to study and live the life she wanted. So that certainly made me a feminist very early. And a huge believer in gender equality. Being a woman in politics hasn't always been a hassle, but it certainly makes you feel, because that's true, as an outsider. You obviously have to fight against stereotypes, not just gender stereotypes, but in reality, all kinds of stereotypes. And I've learned with time that the best way to answer them and to answer the criticism was humor and turning them into derision. I also think it's important to understand that during a debate, for instance, if you are being interrupted by a man, it's not because you were not firm enough or authoritarian enough. It's only because for years and years we have been taught that some voices matter more than others. That's what we call patriarchy. So instead of questioning ourselves, we should look up to people like Kamala Harris, for instance, who did it very well during the presidential debate in the US by asking to finish what she had to say. And we women have as much to say as men. We should believe in our expertise and our knowledge, but that's not something that is easy to do. There should be a lot of training and education around that at all ages, but also at school. And political norms, you have to remember that they have been built for men. So it's taking a long time to change mentalities, and it also requires a lot of adaptability from women to fit into this political system. I think that is really the few lessons that I have learned of this experience.
there. And I'm going to return to that theme now with all of our guest speakers, starting with Frances, because I want to get your assessment of gender equality in society and particularly education. Education has been highlighted by the United Nations as the fourth Sustainable Development Goal, gender equality the fifth. So what progress has been made in relation to these and what obstacles remain, Frances?
Well, I think it's very clear that in Ireland, huge progress has been made. If you think there was a marriage bar only back, you know, until 1972, and there weren't as many women going to third level and getting further training and so on. And when I'm in the European Parliament and I see the progress that has been made in Ireland, despite outstanding issues, which I will address, when I see some of the attempt to row back on women's rights in some of our members of the union, it's quite disturbing. You see people and politicians from certain member states who do not want to use the word gender equality now. You see people rowing back on rights. You see LGBTQI rights being, you know, people saying we can't have this, we want, you know, LGBTQI zones and so on. Really disturbing human rights issues continuing within Europe. But I would say that from an education point of view, tremendous progress has been made in breaking down stereotypes, I suppose. Very early on when I was in my political career, we were looking at textbooks that had very stereotyped in school books, really stereotyped stories about young boys, young girls. I think we're changing all of that. We're opening up the world far more to young girls and of course, young men. And I think that's really good. We see much higher numbers in universities. In many courses, we see, you know, more than 50% of females doing, whether it's law or medicine, so on. The issue is more as people progress in their careers and come up against the very issue that both of our other speakers on the panel have spoken about, and that is combining work and family life, having the childcare supports, the caring demands, the unequal division of care in our society, and the lack of value on it, really. But from an opportunities point of view, there's still a class element, of course. There's still a socioeconomic bar because of costs, and that is something we have to continue to work on. And there is another area where you're seeing inequality. And interestingly enough, Martina, it's in the AI's digital technology area. And connectivity is going to be so important for opportunities as we progress, opportunities to get good healthcare, to get more education, smart agriculture and so on. That is an area where for some reason right across Europe there is a digital gap, there's a gender digital gap, and that's something we really have to work harder on. And that is about women taking the subjects of science and maths and so on, and young girls seeing that that is a potential career because that's where the money is going to be. That can help deal with the gender pay gap and the pension pay gap. So I think in other parts of the world, we have serious issues. Like during COVID, we've seen an increase, for example, in female genital mutilation. We've seen an increase in early marriages. Now, if you have early marriages around the world, less chance of education. There's a real danger of both young men and young boys and girls dropping out of education with the consequences of COVID, because education has been curtailed in many areas. So I think, you know, there are ongoing issues, and I am reading about the need to make up for the lost time during COVID as well with our young people. And many people are saying that we may not catch up on some of the educational experience that has been lost around the world, that it's a real challenge. So I think education is clearly the key for so much progress, for opening doors. It's a good news story in many parts of the world, but there are still issues. And particularly then, as people progress in their careers, you end up having that gender pay gap. You end up maybe not having women at senior levels. You end up with women being more likely to be doing the care responsibilities and more likely to suffer setbacks in careers. That's kind of a broad answer to that question, Martina. Sorry, are you on silent?
In fairness, it was a broad question because there's so much you could talk about in relation to that issue. By the way, on the tech issue that you raised, There's some positive news today. Irish female founders have raised more than 100 million for the first time, but just 16% of founders here are female. So there are barriers across the board, and you mentioned that in your speech. I now am going to move to the minister, to Minister Conari, and I know you wanted to raise some other points, but Minister, also in relation to dealing with gender equality in society and in education in particular, which will have been important to you.
Merci beaucoup, mais avant de répondre à cette question, permettez-moi de revenir un peu sur le thème de l'engagement, qui va me servir d'introduction, je crois, pour aborder cette deuxième question. Je parlais d'engagement intellectuel, en effet, qui est aussi vraiment le socle de mon travail de tous les jours. Et très tôt, très vite, moi, j'ai eu la chance de tomber dans un monde de livres, de m'imprégner de livres, de lectures et de m'ouvrir sur le monde, mais vraiment d'aller au-delà de nos frontières nationales et peut-être à travers le livre, de capter une culture de la paix et de la tolérance. Et devenue adulte, lorsque j'ai terminé de faire mes études, des études complètement différentes, hein, des études scientifiques, j'ai décidé de devenir éditrice. Parce que je me suis souvenue de combien le livre a été important pour moi. Il a été le compagnon de mes jeunes années. Et quand je me suis retrouvée en France pour mes études, le livre a été mon confident. J'ai énormément lu. J'ai appris à m'ouvrir sur le monde, à comprendre davantage mon environnement, qui était l'environnement en France. Et donc, lorsqu'il s'agit pour moi de choisir un métier, c'est automatiquement vers le métier du livre, vers l'édition que je suis allée. Je me suis formée rapidement et je suis devenue éditrice. Et moi qui ai baigné effectivement dans un environnement de militants politiques, je ne peux pas dire que la fibre politique ne me touchait pas ou ne m'habitait pas. J'avais une part de politique en moi et le livre, me semble-t-il, était le bon outil, l'instrument approprié pour faire de la politique et pour mener un combat d'émancipation, surtout au niveau des femmes. Et ce combat se situait à plusieurs niveaux. D'abord, faciliter l'accès des petites filles au livre, à la lecture. Deux, permettre aux femmes d'écrire, de dire leurs pensées, de témoigner de leur quotidien, non pas oralement, mais par écrit, afin que cela soit consigné. Et puis trois, de revisiter le patrimoine immatériel qui est aussi largement nourri par les femmes. Et enfin, pouvoir, à travers les livres documentaires, témoigner de l'engagement du combat des femmes, surtout des militantes politiques. Et vous l'avez souligné d'ailleurs en introduction en me présentant, nous avons il y a 5 ans publié un livre que j'ai vraiment mené d'un bout à l'autre avec une directrice bien sûr de collaboration. Il s'agissait quoi dans ce livre? C'est qu'il y a 5 ans, on était à un tournant historique. Le Mali a vécu ce qu'on appelait mars 1991. Et mars 1991 a été l'événement déclencheur de la révolution démocratique et de l'ouverture démocratique au Mali. Et c'était aussi le moment où les femmes commençaient à s'installer dans la case de la politique. Et les femmes ont joué un rôle important pour l'avènement de cette démocratie. Parce qu'elle ne s'est pas fait de moi cet avènement sans souffrance, sans violence. Et les femmes ont été les premières confrontées à la violence. Lorsque les enfants sont descendus dans la rue pour faire face au régime militaire et aux balles, ce sont vraiment les femmes qui se sont interposées. Et c'est le témoignage d'une des femmes que nous avons interviewées. Ce sont les femmes qui se sont interposées entre les jeunes et les balles. Elles ont été un peu de chair à canon, elles ont payé un lourd tribut. Et je voulais, à travers ce livre, les rendre hommage, mais surtout de rappeler combien les femmes participent à la marche pour l'émancipation politique d'un pays. Si les femmes n'avaient pas joué le rôle qu'elles ont eu à jouer il y a 30 ans maintenant, le Mali ne serait peut-être pas dans un État démocratique. Et elles ont payé de leur sang. Elles ont donné souvent le meilleur d'elles-mêmes, parce que les femmes ont été touchées par des balles, mais les enfants ont aussi été criblés de balles. J'ai lu dans des interviews que certaines femmes ont perdu pratiquement tous leurs enfants. Donc, cette démocratie dans laquelle nous sommes installés, nous la devons parce que les femmes ont été à l'avant-garde du combat. Mais elles ont été ces mêmes femmes à souligner que lorsque le pouvoir a commencé à s'installer, les premières instances de direction ont été installées sans les femmes. Et ce qui m'arrive vraiment à parler des questions d'égalité. Les questions d'égalité au niveau de la sphère politique, ces questions restent encore des questions à des batailles à mener du moins, des batailles à mener, parce qu'en 2014, j'ai des chiffres, au Mali, sur 147 députés, nous n'avions que 9 femmes. Sur 703 maires de communes, nous n'avions que 8, me semble-t-il, et sur 36 diplomates, on n'en avait que 3. Pourtant, le Mali a adopté une loi en 2015, une loi 052, qui prévoit un quota de 30% pour les postes électifs et nominatifs. Tout ça pour vous dire que malgré tout l'engagement, malgré le sacrifice et malgré cette, comme je l'avais dit aussi, cette disposition naturelle à faire de la politique, la bataille pour la politique, la bataille pour occuper la sphère publique n'est pas encore une bataille gagnée par les femmes. Mais revenons aux questions d'éducation. Mais à l'éducation, j'ajouterai aussi une dimension culture. La bataille pour l'égalité, pour moi, c'est aussi la bataille pour l'éducation et la bataille pour la culture. La bataille pour l'éducation, depuis, on va dire, 3 décennies, 4 décennies, nous avons une cellule spéciale au niveau national, une cellule nationale de la scolarisation des filles, qui a des antennes partout dans le pays et qui s'occupe bien sûr donc des conditions de scolarisation et de la promotion de la scolarisation des filles. Mais en 30 ans d'existence, c'est l'ONG One justement qui, dans un de ses derniers rapports, met l'accent sur le fait que le Mali est parmi les 10 pays où le taux de scolarisation des filles est en dessous de la moyenne souhaitée. Je pense que nous sommes autour de 30. Donc, il y a vraiment une bataille à mener à ce niveau-là. C'est la bataille des chiffres, passer de 30% à un taux plus élevé. Mais au-delà de la question de la scolarisation, pour ce qui concerne l'éducation, c'est vraiment l'accès à l'éducation tout court. Comment apprendre aux filles à lire? Comment apprendre aux filles à compter pour qu'elles soient plus émancipées économiquement, pour qu'elles accèdent à l'autonomisation? Et cet accès à l'éducation directe ne peut se faire qu'à travers des voies informelles et aussi en s'appuyant sur les langues maternelles. Nous avons la chance au Mali d'avoir au moins 13 langues maternelles qui sont instrumentées. C'est-à-dire, c'est des langues avec lesquelles nous pouvons lire. C'est les langues avec lesquelles nous pouvons compter. C'est vraiment d'apprendre aux filles à lire, à écrire et à compter pour encore un accès à l'autonomisation. Mais même au niveau des filles qui sont scolarisées, il faudrait aussi quand même mettre l'accent sur une problématique de taille. C'est la déperdition scolaire. Une chose est de mettre la petite fille à l'école, mais une chose est de la maintenir à l'école pour qu'elle puisse avoir un diplôme. Un diplôme qui lui garantisse quoi? Un diplôme qui lui garantisse un emploi. Et cela n'est pas une bataille gagnée d'avance. Et au niveau de la culture, la problématique culturelle est aussi une problématique de bataille. Vraiment, j'aime bien ce mot parce que ça montre la lutte. Qu'il y a encore des domaines sur lesquels les femmes n'ont pas définitivement gagné le combat. Au niveau culturel, lorsqu'on revisite notre patrimoine historique surtout, nous nous rendons compte, là encore une fois, du rôle primordial que les femmes ont joué. Que ce soit les reines de nos grands empires, aux martyrs de la révolution dont je parlais tantôt, de la révolution démocratique, les femmes ont été à l'avant-garde. Il s'agit pour nous de les réhabiliter vraiment dans ce rôle qu'elles ont eu à jouer. Et aussi, les femmes sont les détentrices du patrimoine immatériel. Le patrimoine immatériel, ce sont nos valeurs, ce sont nos savoir-faire. Si les femmes ne sont pas là pour transmettre ces valeurs, si les femmes ne sont pas là pour transmettre ces savoir-faire, ces savoir-faire vont disparaître. Ce patrimoine immatériel va disparaître. Et lorsqu'un savoir-faire disparaît, lorsqu'un patrimoine immatériel disparaît, c'est un peuple qui disparaît en même temps. Donc, il est important dans la bataille pour l'égalité que les femmes soient réhabilitées dans leur rôle en tant que gardienne du temple, en tant que gardienne de nos traditions, mais qu'elles soient aussi réhabilitées par rapport à l'histoire parce qu'elles ont joué un rôle énormément dense pour la consolidation de nos pays, pour la majesté de nos États, pour la majesté de nos empires.
And Minister, clearly, thank you. This is a very passionate, you feel very passionately about this issue, given the role of women towards democracy in your own country, and also in terms of those stark statistics that you have given us in relation to education, participation, and girls. So this is clearly a very issue that you feel very strongly about, and also it gives us all something to think about in terms of the role of women past and also the potential of those young girls in the education system. Najat, you work for an organization, and education, I'm sure, is very key in tackling poverty and extreme poverty. And you also have obviously a record, a distinguished record, as being France's first woman to hold the Ministry of Education effectively.
Yeah, what is very frustrating about politics is that sometimes good measures, obvious measures, clearly approved by the population are sacrificed for political maneuvers. That's often the case with gender-related measures. As a Minister of Women's Rights and Education, I have been the target of many fake news surrounding a mechanism I wanted to introduce in schools, which would have included some education on gender equality and stereotypes for young kids. A huge backlash followed the introduction of this measure, even though it wasn't radical or extremist in any way. So, well, that's the first thing. A difficulty in assessing gender equality in our own countries and in others is the blatant lack of gender data. This is a serious issue because the lack of data also implies that gender discriminations are always underestimated. It also makes it more difficult to draft efficient public policies and to target the right audience. No data, unfortunately, often is a way to make the issue disappear, because if we cannot quantify the issue, then it means that the issue doesn't exist. And third, I would say that another major issue is now COVID-19. We have to talk about it. Recently, it has been estimated that we had lost 25 years of gender equality progress in only 1 year of pandemic. This is absolutely catastrophic. And for now, this is not addressed by governments through gender-specific measures. You know, after the first lockdown in France, I have published a book with a French philosopher, a book called Society of Vulnerable People, Feminist Lessons of a Crisis. In this book, we assess the impact of COVID-19 on gender equality in France and in the world. Women have lost a lot in many areas during the pandemic. That's true in France, but the crisis has also exacerbated vulnerabilities in countries with significant fragilities in terms of food security, economy. There, women have also been the first casualty of cultural and individual violence, child marriage, unwanted pregnancies, school dropouts, genital mutilation, all these phenomena are rising, and Kadiatou can probably tell us more about that. But more generally, the crisis has wiped out decades of progress in gender equality by reaffirming women as heads of households, handling most of domestic and educative chores while also sacrificing their jobs when family needed to come first. The crisis has made domestic violence cases rise uncontrollably. Again, policy responses to those issues were crafted without the contribution of women, overtaken by the valued expertise of men in power. Women's reality was once more subordinated to the priorities selected by the political discourses, which are men's discourses. So in the book, we explain, for instance, that care workers, cashiers, health workers, maids, have showed during this crisis how essential they were to avoid a complete breakdown of our societies. Yet, those care workers are very poorly appreciated and recognized in France, and I think it's the same in other countries. And these jobs are mainly occupied by women. The COVID-19 crisis has brought to light the paradoxical nature of our current social hierarchies, in which the most useful citizens are also given the least recognition. Indeed, the crisis has impacted the vulnerable ones first and has highlighted inequalities. And it has also shown that at the roots of our social organizations' disparities, at the roots, is this idea that a woman is always a little less legitimate, a little less competent, a little less important than a man. That's why I say that in many ways, this crisis has made women, the big majority of care workers, more vulnerable. So for me, that's a real topic that we have to face. I don't want to be too negative, so I will try to end on a positive note. We also have to highlight positive changes. For instance, in France, the extension of the mandatory paternal leave in France, which is interesting because, as Kadiatou said it, now we have to fight on the cultural level to end patriarchy means to make men as committed as women in the domestic life, in the parental life. So I think the progress have to be found in this area especially.
Some important issues there. You've raised some important issues there in relation to COVID-19 and its impact on women. And I'm going to ask the other panelists to very briefly, if they can, because we do want to get to some of our questions from our audience, and we're concluding at 5:30. But Frances Fitzgerald, if you were to look at what you want to come out of COVID and your vision for the future, very briefly, what would you say? What would you identify as those key issues?
Look, thanks, Martina. I agree with what Nasha has to say. I mean, COVID is the issue at the moment in terms of gender equality and the recovery from it. What I want to see is the huge funds that have never before been available, the amount from Europe going to each member state. I want to make sure that the recovery is inclusive of these issues around gender. So that, for example, we are taking account of the precarious position of women's employment. Women have lost more jobs. In order for women to get back into the economy and to have opportunities, the recovery is going to have to take that into account. It's going to have, you can't just think, for example, of construction. construction is extremely important, but you can create millions of jobs around Europe by building a care economy. So that is something we really have to deal with, the childcare issue, the care of the elderly. We've seen what's happened in long-term care. So we have to be conscious that there is a differential impact from COVID, and every recovery plan and every government policy going forward for the next number of years has to be aware of that, has to deal with it in its policies, in its program for governments, in its actions. We also, of course, have to be very, and we haven't mentioned it to any degree so far, there has been a 30% increase across Europe of domestic violence. I can't believe we're still talking about domestic violence, but we are, sadly. So you need really strong support to the organisations working with women. We need to address this issue in our law as well. We've done quite a lot in Ireland. I was involved myself in bringing in the concept of coercive control and the definition of consent. These issues are very important. So across Europe, we have to make sure that we look at the care issues that have arisen. We look at the access to healthcare, cancer screening, you know, whether it's breast cancer screening, access to sexual and reproductive rights. This has all been interrupted as we have moved forward. And in my report, which was agreed by the European Parliament just 2 weeks ago, I look at the impact of COVID-19 in about seven different areas: the economy, domestic violence, healthcare, and so on, and make recommendations. And Naja made a point as well, and I'm sure Kadia Tiotu would agree as well, that you need gender disaggregated data. If you don't do research that's inclusive of women, for example, in medicine, we're not going to give women the right treatment. And that has been a problem over the years and continues to be an issue. So gender disaggregated data in all areas is completely critical moving forward. And government can lead on this and really point to the areas where we need to be addressing the inequalities. And of course, Martina, I'd finish by saying, you know, everyday sexism is something we have to watch as well, whether it's in the media or in the day-to-day experiences we all have, and particularly young women. When you think of the impacts of pornography and expectations of, you know, having to look a certain way, this can be very debilitating and actually stop women and young girls from even contributing in classrooms. So that's a broader issue we have to continue to address.
And that's an issue that you have spoken about previously and expanded on, the pressures and also the fact that it discourages women from entering politics and other professions in public life. Thank you, Frances. Minister, in relation to a post-COVID environment, briefly, if you could see that your visions for the future and what needs to be addressed, because we really do want to get to our audience questions.
Merci beaucoup. Je crois qu'il est, il est très important, ou il est très difficile du moins, de parler de futur aujourd'hui, de parler d'avenir sans tenir compte de cette pandémie de la COVID-19. Mes priorités, ma vision, je vais vraiment les recentrer autour des différents secteurs qui dépendent du département, à savoir la culture, l'artisanat et le tourisme. Et en effet, pour le secteur artisanal comme pour le secteur touristique, il y a un monde avant le COVID et un monde après le COVID. Nous avons appris depuis quelques mois, lorsque les frontières ont été fermées, le Mali, qui malgré la crise sécuritaire continuait à recevoir des touristes, le Mali s'est vu sévré de touristes internationaux. Plus aucun flux de voyageurs, alors que notre industrie touristique reposait en grande partie sur ce flux international. Et lorsque les touristes arrivaient, qu'est-ce qu'ils aimaient peut-être le plus, ou vers quel secteur ils se dirigeaient le plus? C'est le secteur artisanal. Ils allaient à la rencontre de la créativité des artisans du Mali. Et donc, pas de touristes, pas de développement vraiment de l'artisanat, et nous avons donc été obligés de mûrir une réflexion, de dire il nous faut impérativement nous donner les moyens de développer le tourisme local, le tourisme national, pour permettre au tourisme de vivre, de survivre, parce qu'encore une fois, il y a le monde d'avant et le monde d'après, et mettre donc des outils à la disposition du secteur touristique pour qu'il y ait justement cette promotion du tourisme local. Et pour ce qui me concerne et pour ce qui nous concerne au niveau du département, nous comptons énormément nous appuyer sur les ressources locales féminines. Parce que l'artisanat est détenu en grande partie par les artisans, par les femmes. Vous voyez les métiers comme la poterie, la vannerie, le tissage, j'en parlais tantôt, la teinture. L'artisanat est constitué d'énormément de métiers féminins. Il faudrait vraiment revaloriser ces métiers et permettre aux femmes d'en tirer un bénéfice économique. Et au niveau touristique également, on peut s'appuyer du développement du tourisme local, on pourra s'appuyer sur les ressources féminines. Je l'ai dit à l'entame de mes propos, c'est que la femme, c'est celle qui sait recevoir, c'est celle qui sait entretenir la maison. On a une culture ici, c'est la culture de l'hospitalité. On appelle cette culture la jatigia, c'est vraiment l'art de recevoir. Je me dis que ce art de recevoir, on va tout simplement le transposer de la cellule familiale à la cellule nationale, à la cellule citoyenne. Donc nos femmes de maîtresses de maison pourraient très facilement devenir des gardiennes de la cité en célébrant cette jatigia, ce art de l'hospitalité qui est un art incontournable dans le développement de l'industrie touristique. Quant aux aspects de culture, les défis sont énormes. Les défis sont énormes, mais la vision est là. La vision est là. Lorsque nous sommes arrivés au niveau du département, très rapidement, nous avons organisé des concertations au niveau des différentes branches du secteur culturel. Ça voudrait dire quoi? On a fait s'asseoir autour d'une table tout le monde du cinéma, aussi bien les acteurs publics que les partenaires techniques, les acteurs eux-mêmes, les opérateurs eux-mêmes, pour discuter de l'avenir de leur métier. Et nous avons fait cet exercice au niveau de toutes les disciplines culturelles, la musique, les arts pratiques, la danse, etc. Et il en est ressorti un certain nombre de recommandations qui sont vraiment le fruit de concertations. Et nous allons mettre en application ces recommandations. Mais je tiens à vous signaler la spécificité ou la particularité de la période que nous traversons au Mali. Nous sommes dans un gouvernement de transition, c'est-à-dire un gouvernement de mission, un gouvernement qui aide à aller vers les élections, qui aide à préparer le jour après les élections. Et nous avons la responsabilité, prêtez-moi l'expression, d'assainir la maison, de faire en sorte que les choses soient nettes pour que ceux qui vont arriver puissent prendre les rênes en marche. Donc, nous avons un certain nombre de travaux qui vont aller dans ce sens-là pour vraiment rendre la maison, assainir la maison. Et enfin, j'aimerais, et ça, c'est une prière même.
I'm just going to come in now because I know Najat has a half 12 end, whether you may have a few more minutes with Francis.
Okay.
Najat, can I ask you, because some questions have come in from the audience, and I was just wondering, one is commending France and Mexico in relation to transforming the agricultural systems. But also asking, how can women have a greater influence in agriculture and food systems? Because that's also important in tackling poverty and extreme poverty. So I'm going to ask, it's a very specific question, but I think it's an important one. And that question comes from Rose Hogan.
Yeah, hi, Rose. That's absolutely essential. And we absolutely share the idea that the first problem in the developing countries especially is the fact that so many women are working on agriculture but do not master their work, do not own the fields and so on and so on. So that is absolutely right. And we are going to put this topic on the gender equality forum that is going to be organized in France in a few months. But if you allow me, let me maybe try to answer another question that I have seen on the Q&A from Claire Laudet. who is asking us, whilst in Ireland the number of women studying engineering and science has increased, the number of men studying nursing or social work is not increasing in the same way. What would you suggest could be done to redress that imbalance, as I believe that full equality won't happen as long as some jobs are deemed feminine? She is so right. She is so right. And to come back to your question, I hope the post-COVID world will recognize our vulnerabilities and the value of care, which should not be women's concern, but a concern for society as a whole. The lack of consideration for jobs which are mostly occupied by women today, the jobs in the care area, this lack of consideration is frightening. And for me, it is linked to the fact that in our general unconscious, the functions occupied by these cashiers, housekeepers, other caretakers are merely the extension of the domestic field. A field which is discredited and is supposed to rest on women's shoulders in a kind of natural altruism or generosity. And we see it wrongly as a natural extension of the domestic field. That's why these jobs don't have any right recognition of the harness of these jobs. That's why they are paid very badly and are known to decrease life expectancy and so on and so on. So to answer the question of Claire, I will say that you're right. We must promote all these professions to make them attractive, including for men, attractive financially speaking, but also attractive culturally speaking. And for that, television has a huge role to play in my mind. I don't know if it is the same in other countries, but when I look at my country, look at the cooking shows at TV, which have a lot of success and increasingly bring men into the kitchen. So I think we should have the same kind of promotion and, you know, making the jobs more attractive, including other dimension of the domestic area, dealing with children, housekeeping and so on and so on. Same kind of TV shows that should make all these functions more attractive. And I think that's something that we should really deal with, yeah. That would be my conclusion.
And I'm glad that you jumped in there and spotted that question. It was my next one. But Frances, you will also be very familiar with that issue as someone who started off in social work. But I actually have a specific question that's been coming for you. And I'd ask if all of our speakers are very brief, because we literally have about 3 minutes left. But Frances, not even 3 minutes to ask this question. But Ian Hughes has asked, what is the difference in having 1, 2, 3, or 4 women in cabinet in terms of policy? That's a fair question.
Yes, it is a very fair question and hard to summarize, but I would say it's obviously about hearing the voices of women and men. It's about critical mass. When you have critical mass, you get a fairer distribution of discussion. I know, and I'll finish on this, when President Obama had his cabinet and the women found that they weren't being listened to and they decided they'd go for what they called amplification, which means that if one woman said something, another woman would support her, as opposed to one woman saying something, another man saying the same, and then whoever was leading the discussion saying, oh, that's a great idea, John, and forgetting that the woman had said it, which I had that experience again and again in all sorts of settings. So I think it's about voice. My own experience as well is that women behave less hierarchically in cabinet, which kind of surprised me, actually. I found that women were more, it's hard to generalize because obviously there are always differences and exceptions between men and women, are not for a moment suggesting a man might do this, but I often found that women were willing to call the elephant in the room and to sort of say, but what about, you know, the fact that people are saying X or Y, or that we're really concerned about this aspect of some legislation you're bringing in or some current issue. So I found a sort of a straightforwardness actually, in women, and less inclined to kind of go with a hierarchical, you don't say anything, which surprised me in men. But politics is very hierarchical, and you're often dependent on leaders for positions. So maybe that explains it. But look, at the main point, I think, is that you absolutely need the best thinking of women and men working together for our country. And as you move from, you know, 1 to 5 women in cabinet, you're getting different experiences reflected as well. And, you know, very often I found women were very practical about issues as well in cabinet, because, you know, we bring, as our contributors are saying, you just bring that experience of combining work and family life and, you know, housework and caring. And, you know, you bring it all together and you bring it to your politics as well. And thanks, Martina.
Not all. Najat was smiling throughout that, so I know that she agrees in terms of political participation and having more women. Very briefly, Minister, what about you? Do you believe it makes a difference having more women around the cabinet table? You are serving in senior office at the moment. So, Minister, do you believe it is important to have more women in senior roles in politics?
Oui, forcément. Forcément, c'est ce que j'ai dit à l'entame de mes propos. Je crois très sincèrement.
Hello.
Hello. Je continue. Oui. Ce que je disais à l'entame de mes propos, c'est que je pense que les femmes sont vraiment, de par leur culture, en tout cas ici au Mali, et dans un certain nombre de pays africains, de par leur éducation, de par leur parcours, elles sont naturellement outillées à prendre des responsabilités. Et lorsqu'elles se retrouvent sur la scène politique, sur la scène publique, c'est avec beaucoup de responsabilités qu'elles assument leurs fonctions. Lorsque les femmes arrivent sur la scène politique, nous avons vu toutes les questions qui concernent, par exemple, le changement climatique, les questions qui concernent l'éducation, les questions qui concernent un meilleur devenir, l'autonomisation même des autres femmes, elles donnent le meilleur d'elles-mêmes pour que cela puisse se faire. Donc, oui, il faut vraiment plaider pour un large accès des femmes au partage des charges politiques.
Thank you, Minister. And also, thank you to all of our guest speakers today, Frances Fitzgerald, Kadia Tu, Konere. Thank you very much for joining us from Mali. And also Najat Balo Balkhassam, who had to go just there. I would also like to thank the IEA and the French Embassy, in particular the French Ambassador to Ireland, Vincent Guiron, and the Cultural Councillor of the French Embassy in Dublin, Mariam Diallo, and all the IEA team, Clodagh, Hannah, Lorcan, and also the interpreter, Veronica, who's done a huge